For those of you who have been counting, we're now about 5 weeks past the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and of course the Passover that preceded it, which means we're only a few weeks away from Pentecost. But looking back to those spring holy days, we know that one of the lessons was to walk away from sin or come out of sin. Historically, the Israelites did this literally. They spent the historic week of the Days of Unleavened Bread walking out of Egypt. On that last day of that week, they crossed the Red Sea on the last day of Unleavened Bread, leaving that physical nation of Egypt, but also picturing for us and for them even, leaving sin behind. But in looking at the lesson that's there, taking their example, we can see that in order to successfully walk away from sin, we have to have a plan to replace that sinful behavior with something better in terms of having godly behavior. It's not enough just to remove something. You have to have something better to put it in its place. The first step, then, in removing sin in our life is to examine ourselves. We touch on this verse in 1 Corinthians 11:28 many times during that time of year. We'll come to it here a little later in the sermon. But in order to analyze coming out of sin, we first have to see where that sin is in our lives. And when we honestly examine ourselves spiritually, we have to take a look at the habits we have, because so many times sin becomes a habit like so many other things. Starting with a good habit, though, isn't easy, is it? There are a number of reasons for that, and we'll cover some of that today, but we all know that we should probably eat better, exercise more, get better sleep, not waste so much time in meaningless activities, and many other things. But we rarely get around to implementing those good habits, and a big part of that is one of the laws of physics, right? A body in motion tends to stay in motion. We just tend to do what we know. We continue in those habits. The other obstacle that we have is that we want results now. Whenever we want something to change, we don't want to wait. We want it now. And that's not usually how these things want. We don't think about our habits because we built them over time. But when we want to change them, we don't want to give it the same kind of time that it took to build it in the first place. But we should be more concerned, even in considering all those things, with our current trajectory rather than our current habits. And when we talk about changing habits, we're really talking about changing our identity. We don't tend to think that way, but our habits really kind of identify who we are. Let's start today in Scripture in Proverbs 23, because in order to change what we get, in order to change our outcomes, we have to change our processes. Now, that may sound too, whatever, cerebral, analytical, but you have to change what you do in order to get a change, to get a different outcome. Hopefully that's clear to everybody, because our identity involves what we believe, and those belief patterns become habits. They become what we show, what we do. In Proverbs 23, then, in verse 7, we read here, "For as he, as a man, thinks in his heart, so is he." What we internalize in our thinking, what we take in terms of even entertainment, what we read, all of these things, they do become who we are, what we exhibit. And as we can read in Luke 6, as Christ said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So what we fill our lives with is usually what we reflect outwardly. But even God looks at our calling this way, if you will. Let's look at Romans 4. He wants us to be filled with his way of life, so that's what we reflect. Romans 4, and in verse 17, says, "For as it is written," breaking into thought here, he says, "I have made you a father of many nations," speaking of Abraham, "in the presence of him whom he blessed." This is the part that I want to emphasize. God, who gives life to the dead, us, everyone eventually, but us now, we're spiritually dead before God called us. So he gives us life. He gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. So even as how God interacts with us, he doesn't interact at really where he sees us. He interacts with us where he sees that he wants us to be. And that's a different way of seeing everything then. But what we see in this, that even God is working the outcome that he wants. His plan for expanding his family started with creating the angelic realm, and then creating the universe, and then creating mankind, And then knowing the weakness of mankind, that was part of his plan as well, to develop character. Knowing that weakness, though, he sent his son for the payment of our sins, and he's directed human events all through the course of mankind's history. So, to get to the point of today, how do we walk out of sin? How do we walk away from sin in a practical sense? I believe we can overcome any aspect of our carnal nature by establishing a positive habit to replace it. So then the title of my sermon today is Making a Plan to Come Out of Sin. In order for us to be in God's family, in order for Him to give us eternal life, it's axiomatic that we have to overcome our human nature. We have to change that. We have to become like Him. Let's look at one example of this in Revelation 2. In chapters 2 and 3 of Revelation, we have these letters that are written to the seven churches that represent aspects of all of God's people, attitudes, characteristics, personalities, if you will. And in every one of these letters, the summary at the end is, as we'll read here now, Revelation 2, verse 26, just one example here. And he who overcomes and keeps my works until the end, to him I will give power over the nations, that we will inherit rulership, but we have to overcome. The Greek word here for overcome in the English, in the Greek, is nikaho, and it means to subdue or conquer, to prevail or get the victory. This is what our marching orders are, if you will, that we have to look at our lives and we have to conquer those things that are not godly. And so this offer is to us, this what we read here in verse 26, that God has called some in this lifetime, the balance of mankind He'll call in the future. We understand that through the holy days. But He's called us now to have the responsibility to overcome and show others that it is possible, that God's nature in us will bring us to a different conclusion than mankind apart from God. That is, we're called to an overcoming life. And that can seem overwhelming at times, can't it? If we dive really deep for a long period of time, we see so many things that we need to change, we don't always see the things that are good. And we can be overwhelmed by that, because without the right direction or the right tools, we can then just be overwhelmed by, when you have too many choices, you don't know what to choose. But we do have the tools to overcome, to make these habits, these godly habits, part of who we are. And when you look at establishing any habit, there are four aspects of it. And I'll just touch on these here, and I'll refer to them in general as we progress, but this is not the heart of what I'm getting to. But for any habit, there are four things that happen. The craving, the response, and the reward. The cue is the trigger that initiates the behavior. I'm hungry. I want something to eat. That's the cue, right? You feel your stomach rumble. You say, okay, well, that's the craving. I want to satisfy. The cue is the rumble. The craving is I want to satisfy that. What can I have to eat? So you go prepare something. The response is what leads to the expected reward. I've made the food. Now I can eat it. The reward is the end goal. Now I'm not hungry anymore. We can look at that on a physical response, and we can reflect this in a spiritual way. So again, it's cue, which is the trigger for the behavior, craving, which is the anticipated change, the response, which is the habit that leads to the reward, and then the reward is what satisfies us. So then how do we begin to overcome or address sinful habits if we want to overcome? Well, the simple answer is if you eliminate any one of those four steps, you probably won't do it long term. If you eliminate the cue, then the habit will not start, or the behavior will not continue. If you reduce the craving, then the motivation to act will not be strong enough. If you make the behavior difficult, this is the response. So if the response is difficult, you won't do it. And if the reward doesn't satisfy, then there's no reason to repeat the behavior. Remove, again, any one of those, and the behavior doesn't become a habit. We might do it once or twice, and we realize none of that satisfies. So in considering then those four actions, there's another four-step process that happens that usually is running in the background, that is active in pretty much every aspect of our day. So it's four laws of behavior change. And we're adapting our behavior all the time. We did it today, didn't we? We came in the wrong door. It didn't feel right. We'll have to repeat that behavior for a while. Some people are sitting in the wrong seats today. That changes other people's behaviors. That's in quote. They're not in the wrong seats. We just mixed it up. You know. So it's like, wait a minute. We don't sit here. Today we are. So here are the four laws of behavior change. Can I make it obvious? Can I make it attractive? Can I make it easy? And can I make it satisfying? So we're going to go through those four things today. So let's look at the first one, making it obvious. We do all kinds of things without thinking about them. Even our physical life. We don't have to think to breathe, do we? We don't have to think to swallow, usually. We don't have to think to blink our eyes. There are a lot of things our body does for us, just sort of on autopilot. We do these things in life as well. We go to work a certain way. We got errands to run. We do a certain pattern of behavior, all of these things. These habits are ingrained in our brain because it recognizes the cue. The craving begins, usually without us even thinking about it. We respond with an action to satisfy and get the reward. So we see this even in skills. You do any one job for a while, and you can pick up a lot of things because you become so ingrained in how things should work. So a healthcare professional that can pick up on an illness, they can see something in a person. Maybe it's something in their eyes or something in their fingernails or the way they hold their body, any number of things. And they can almost diagnose a person just on some simple things. You know, somebody in a trade is usually maddening, isn't it? You look up and you say, well, that wasn't done right. You can pick up on what was the shortcut where somebody didn't do a step they were supposed to. But let's go to 1 Corinthians 11. Normally we read verse 28, but I want to read verse 31. So 1 Corinthians 11, verse 31. We'll read 1 Corinthians 11, 28 here in just a second. So 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 31, Paul writes here, "For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged." This then reflects what we read in verse 28, that a man, a person, is to examine himself. Now, Paul, it seems, was writing this around the time of Passover and unleavened bread. It's because he says, let us eat of the bread and drink of the cup. So that's where we start, isn't it? With God's calling, responding, doing the things that God tells us to do, which is his commandments, the principles of godly living that we have in Scripture. But we have to start with this examination so that we can judge ourselves. So making it obvious means that we have to see what it is, even if we're not thinking about it, that is obvious that our body begins to respond to, our mind. Because again, changing a habit is hard because usually we're not even aware of the habit. So we have, even in Lamentations 3, verse 40, and Galatians 6, verse 4, we have the same thought about examining ourselves. Well, you have to stop and take the time to analyze, don't you? Or do you know what shoe you always put on first? I can guarantee you, everybody has a pattern. How you put on a pair of pants, how you put on a coat, what glove you put on first, all these things. We have patterns, but we don't think about it, do we? You know why you don't think about it? Our brains are lazy. Right? Everything that can be automated, it will automate. We don't think about it. It just wants to do it. But to change any of those habits, we must first be aware of the habit. So in order to change anything, we have to know that it exists. And we can make a list of these things. Having gone through the spring holy days, as we anticipate, look forward to Pentecost, what would be your list? It doesn't even have to be a long list, but what would be your list? What is it that God has shown you, or just over time that you've realized with God's Spirit working with you, that you should address spiritually in your life? There's a term in a lot of industries. The phrase is pointing and calling. Does anybody know what that is? The most probably well-known example of this is the pilot and co-pilot in a plane. Right? So the pilot is going through the maneuvers that the co-pilot is calling out. You know, they check the flaps, they check the aileron, they check the fuel, they check all these things that they check. Well, one is saying, the other is doing. And the reason why you do that is, if I'm doing the pointing and the calling, I'm going to make assumptions. Yeah, that's fine. I looked at it yesterday, or, well, when I came in, it didn't seem to have a problem. We'll skip things. Because, again, our brain is lazy, right? We don't want to go through every step. But it's important to do. That's been shown. This pointing and calling has been shown to be a powerful tool to make all of the steps in a process, to make sure that they're covered, that nothing is missed. Maybe that's where we start, in making it obvious. Go through the checklist. What are we supposed to do? Did I do my prayer today? Did I do my Bible study today? Have I meditated on God's Word? You know, these are primary things. What about even the less obvious things that I should do? Along this line of making it obvious, then, you can take any habit and add to it. And this is one of my favorites. It's called stacking habits. So, for instance, if you want to add to your routine at night, what is one of the obvious things you do? Whatever it is that you get ready for bed, just think of brushing your teeth. Okay, so if I'm going to brush my teeth, when I'm done brushing my teeth, I'm going to do X. You've already have a habit established that you can add something to. So you're not creating a brand new, unique habit. You're simply adding to it. Maybe you're really good about doing your prayers in the morning, but not so much your Bible study. You can say, okay, after I pray, I'm just going to read one chapter. It doesn't have to be this huge thing, just something that begins to add to it. The thing is what we're doing is we're adding to something we already do that's positive. And we simply build on those things. And then you can just keep adding to that chain, however long you want to make it. Because the expression is that environment is the invisible hand that shapes human behavior. So we're talking about us changing, making a plan. So what is our environment? This is part of making it obvious as well. Maybe you physically have to declutter your environment to see what's important. I'll give you an example of making it obvious. Advertisers and marketers understand this. The stuff they want you to buy, they make a lot of money on. They make really easy to buy, don't they? They put it at the checkout lanes. They put it on what's called end caps, the end aisles of all the rows. And it doesn't matter what you go into, grocery store, hardware store, retail stores, they all do the same thing, right? The high markup items, the things they want to move, they put at the front of the store. They don't put the milk in the grocery store by the front door. Right? Because if I just need milk, all I got to do is just go through the door, buy the milk, I'm out. They put it all the way in the back. So you have to walk by all the snacks, all the other things, all the things they want you to buy in addition to the milk. Let's look at Romans 16. We need to make it obvious so that, in going back to this pointing and calling, we're not missing anything. In Romans 16, in verse 19, we read this: "For your obedience has become known to all. Therefore, I am glad on your behalf, but I want you to be wise in what is good and simple concerning evil." The word "wise" here means to lust for. That doesn't seem compatible. We tend to think of lusting in a negative sense. But what if we lust for God's way of life? This is everything we want. To be wise in those things, the word "simple" here means innocent or harmless. So, innocent concerning evil, that you don't even know what they're talking about. That happened to me once in a job I had years ago. At the lunch table, the few people were sitting around, and one fellow used a derogatory name for an ethnic group. I had no idea what that was, and I asked him, what does that mean? He was stunned. I didn't know that. I was happy after I heard it that I didn't know it. But he thought everybody would know it, because that's what he thinks in his mind. Let's look at this in 1 Corinthians 15. Sometimes making it obvious is being part of a group where it is obvious. This is part of the value of the Sabbath day, to be surrounded with people of like mind, to be reminded of God's word and what it is that we're a part of, what the calling is, all these sort of things. So in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33, we have a very interesting verse here, because Paul is actually quoting a writer that was familiar during his lifetime. So 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 33, he says here then, "Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits." Now the writer here is Menander. He was a Greek dramatist in the 300s or so BC. This is from a work he wrote called Theas. Evil company corrupts good behavior. It's important who we hang out with. Their behavior is obvious to us, even if it's not behavior obvious to them. So what do? Because we'll reflect our environment. That's what I said earlier, right? Environment is the invisible hand that shapes human behavior. Let's look at one last verse here in this point about making it obvious. 1 Thessalonians 5. 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse 22. "Test all things, hold fast that which is good." And then, I'm sorry, that's verse 21. And then verse 22, "Abstain from every form of evil." We eliminate a bad habit by reducing exposure to the cue. If I know what makes me angry, I should try to avoid that. If I know what environment is a temptation to me, I should avoid that. If I remove the cue, then I can begin to eat more easily, change the behavior. Right, so let's look at the next point then. Making it attractive. When we want to change behavior, the second thing to address is making it attractive, because the more attractive a behavior is, the more likely it will become habit-forming. Because the reason habits are so powerful is that when we engage in these habits, our brains release a hormone called dopamine, and that's the feel-good thing, right? So when we do what we want, what we're anticipating, our brains feel good. But the interesting thing is that dopamine is not only released when you experience pleasure, it's released when you anticipate it, which makes it challenging when it's a bad behavior, because our body is already anticipating it. Because even these studies show that dopamine rises before a habit action. Our brain has more neural circuitry allotted for wanting rewards than for liking them. I find that really interesting. So desire is the engine that drives behavior, not necessarily the satisfying, the desire. And so we come to what's called premix, principle, and that is the more probable behavior will reinforce, the more probable behavior will reinforce less probable behavior. This goes back to the habit stacking. So we know we're prone to something, it will reinforce things that are less probable. This is why sin multiplies. But the converse is true as well. If we replace it with something good, then it will also reinforce other good behavior that is less probable. So let's look at John 14. This making it attractive, one of the simple things that a lot of behavioralists will talk about is what's called the I will statements. And it's as simple as writing it down. Not necessarily just saying it, but writing it down will also reinforce it. I will, and then write whatever it is. I will study my Bible every day. I will avoid whatever behavior. Writing it down begins to reinforce it in our brains. And we see this even in Christ's example, John 14 and in verse 13. He says, "If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." In verse 14, If you ask, I'm sorry, in verse 13, I skipped that one. Whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Verse 14 then, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Verse 21, he who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, notice, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Christ made these kind of I will statements all the time. So what are we talking about? We're talking about making it attractive to know that Christ will back us up when we do the things that God asks us to do. Does that make it attractive? I would hope that it would. Because whatever habits are normal around us are the most attractive to us. This is changing the behavior as well, changing the environment specifically. We don't choose our earliest habits, though. We imitate them. Babies imitate their parents. This is why normal is what you know, right? We grow up thinking normal is what we experience. It may or may not be. But usually we choose the habits of those close to us and those that we associate with or those that we defer to. So as I said, pick your friends wisely because they can be a part of this process of helping you overcome. Maybe going back to the first point, making it obvious is asking your friends, what is obvious to you that I need to change? You have to be very comfortable with your friends, don't you? Because if they're honest with you, they'll probably tell you something that you're not picking up on. Which also then goes back to being with God's people so that the attractive, the normal things are the right things. Surrounding ourselves with those people so that we emulate those things. All right, the third behavioral change is making it easy. When we consider overcoming a spiritual habit, we can't get bogged down in the details of how we're going to overcome. And the reason why is there's no perfect approach. There is no fastest way to overcome. There is no magic bullet to fix a problem. You just have to start. The French writer Voltaire says it this way. Many of you will recognize this quote probably. It says, the best is the enemy of the good. We think, when we're older especially, okay, well, I'd like to learn the guitar. We want to play like we've been playing for 20 years, don't we? We hit the wrong chords, we're not fingering right, you know, all kinds of things we do wrong. And we think, well, that's awful. I'm not going to keep doing that. Well, we can say, okay, well, I've done so many things in my life where I started out not doing it right, the way we fed ourselves, tying our shoes, even put our shoes on. I don't know what it is about kids, how many times they want to put the wrong shoes on the opposite feet. Nope, that's what I want to do. And then they figure out, no, I don't want this. And they learn how to do it right. Just all these kind of things. If we wait for the perfect plan or the perfect time to overcome or change, then we probably never will. Because again, one of the keys to overcoming is to build on positive repetition, not perfection. The trajectory is what we're focused on. So let's look at Isaiah 28. Isaiah 28 in verse 10 is a verse that reflects this very deeply. Now, God is correcting in the context of this chapter, he's correcting Ephraim and Jerusalem. So essentially, all of the tribes of Israel. He's reminding them of the things they're not doing well. And in verse 10 here of Isaiah 28, he says, for precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. We actually see a number of things here. We're building on patterns, aren't we? We're building on repetition. We're building on aspects that are small. Small steps that lead to big steps. Here a little, there a little. This repetition is a form of change. So the question then becomes, how often do we need to repeat that behavior for it to become a habit? And the answer is, it depends on what we want the new behavior to be. If we only do something once a month, it's going to be a longer habit to develop, isn't it? The holy days only come around once a year. The habit of that takes more time to develop, doesn't it? But the Sabbath is here every week. It takes less time to build that habit, doesn't it, of keeping those things? Because no habit develops after one time. Almost universally speaking, habits are built over the course of decades. Because our brain has learned a shortcut. It's internalized the shortcut. We don't even think about it, but we continue to validate it. So we have to break those cycles that we touched on even earlier. Let's look at Colossians chapter 4. This is another principle in general of our Christian calling, but even applies here in what we're covering today. Colossians 4 and verse 1, "Masters, give your bondservants what is just and fair, knowing that you also have a master in heaven." Verse 2, "Continue earnestly in prayer." That's a habit, isn't it? Earnestly, regularly, heartfelt, being vigilant in it with thanksgiving. Meanwhile, praying also for us that God would open the door to speak the mysteries of Christ. Verse 4, "that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak." That is, even Paul, as he recognized him submitting himself to what God would want him to do, that God would reveal to him these things. So verse 5, "walk in wisdom towards those who are outside." Notice, redeeming the time that we essentially try to buy back. Now, we can't buy back yesterday, can we? Can't buy back any of the life that's already passed us. But what this means is that we make the most of what's moving forward. Okay, well, I can't make up for that, so I'll do even better in the future. Because again, humans are lazy. We look for the easy way in life. This is the problem we see in the world around us. But we reflect this because we're still human, aren't we? This outlook, this way, this easy way is called the law of least effort. That's human nature, right? We want to do whatever we need to do with the least amount of effort. Because studies have shown when a person has to decide between two similar options, they'll gravitate to the option that has less work attached to it. Okay? I'm hungry. I want to eat. What are my options? Well, I can go to the store. I can go through the store and buy all the ingredients for whatever meal I want to have. I can put those in bags. I can take them home. I can get out the pots and I can cook everything. Or I can just stop at the restaurant and buy some takeout on the way home. Most people choose takeout. They choose the easy way. Or they go to the store and buy something already made, pop it in a microwave. We determine these things in our lives. The best route to work is the easiest way in our minds. We create a favorite pair of shoes, right? We've all got probably more than one pair of shoes, but we tend to gravitate towards the one pair because there's something about that pair of shoes we really like. We buy the same foods at the grocery store, all these things. And this is why it's critical to make the new habit as easy as possible, because otherwise we'll gravitate back to what's easy. And we come back to environment. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 5. Proverbs 5 and verse 8. "Remove your way far from her, and go near the door of her house." Now, Solomon is writing here about wrong relationships, specifically sexual aspects of this. And so he's essentially saying, stay away from that environment. Remove your way far from her. We can fill in "from her" with anything that we want to overcome. Remove ourselves far from it. Because if we make it less attractive, if we don't make it easy, if we do all these things, it becomes obvious to us, then if we break any one of those again, we're less likely, not very likely at all actually, to repeat those habits. So again, this point that we're covering right now is make it easy. So what would make a new habit, spiritual habit, something you want to grow in or a sin that you want to overcome, what would make it easy? I'm not talking about making it not worth anything. In practice and application, what would make it easy? So it needs to go from the general to the specific. Instead of, I want to read the whole Bible this year, which could be a good goal, you can just say, well, I'm going to read two chapters before I go to bed tonight. How do you make that easy? You put the Bible right there on the table next to your bed, right? Or you put it in the bathroom next to your toothbrush. You just make it as easy as possible. That's just one example. But when we make it easy, we dramatically increase the potential of sticking with it. Because we go back to the first point, right? It's obvious. It's there. I have to willingly, knowingly reject it. So to go back to the cue and craving and all of those other things I talked about, one of the things we need to do is make the bad habits as hard as possible to overcome. Because again, the harder we make it, because our brains are lazy, we don't want to do it. All right, let's look at the last one then. Number four is the fourth behavioral change is make it satisfying. In order to establish any change of behavior, it has to satisfy us in a positive way. It has to satisfy us actually fairly immediately or we won't continue in it. But if our brains are lazy, how do we satisfy it with something good that doesn't have an immediate reward? That's the challenge with any change in behavior, isn't it? Well, the trick is to create a behavior that is immediately satisfying but has a positive long-term outcome. So if I'm saving up for something, I am delaying the gratification, right? I want to buy a house. Well, I have to save up so much money to have a down payment, all these things, or I'm even something lesser. I want to buy a new car, or I want to take a special trip, whatever it is. So we're setting aside certain things. We're not spending money on certain things so that we can save that money. But how do I do that long term? Well, you can remind yourself of what you want the outcome to be. And there's satisfaction in knowing, okay, well, I've given up X, but because I want to do Y, I'm okay with that. Because I want that whatever. I want to be able to buy that new house, that new car, take that trip, whatever it is. Well, the same is true spiritually. Delayed gratification is where good habits pay off. And we can do this in any number of ways. Again, we become creatures of habits. You stop and buy a coffee on the way to work, you buy a donut, or whatever it is that some of your perks are. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't have our own little special things that satisfy and help us make a day special in some ways. But we have to be careful because oftentimes we can spend, especially money, you can get into habits without even realizing how they'll add up. For instance, average Starbucks coffee. I think this is low. I think the internet lied to me. It says the average Starbucks coffee is $2.75. Let's just accept that. If I buy that 5 days a week, 52 weeks a year, that's over $700. Okay, so if you're looking at changing or adding a new behavior, you could say, okay, is it really worth $700 to have that coffee on the way to work? I could still do the coffee if I make it myself. It's a whole lot cheaper. I can still drink it on the way to work or whatever. But we have to feel that immediate satisfaction. So this is another reason why surrounding yourself with the right people is the right thing to do in order to do this overcoming, in order to have the patterns established of the right things. Because then we see even in others how it can be satisfying. Somebody that has already sacrificed for something, and to see the payout, if you will, to see the blessings that come from God on a spiritual level. Another way to make a long-term goal satisfying is to track when you perform that habit, because now you can see a chart of measurement. You can see the work that's gone into it. Ben Franklin did this. I found this years ago when I was in college. It's called 13 virtues that he did. He said, I want to be balanced in life. And he came up with these 13 areas in life. Think of it like spokes on a wheel. The inner part is really bad. The outer part is where he wanted to be. He wanted to have a nice round circle. He didn't do it very long because what he found out is it was a pretty spiky thing. Some things he would do really good on, be way out on the edge. Other things he wasn't so well on when he would analyze it. He couldn't keep it balanced, but it's still a valuable exercise because then he realized, I'm trying to do too much. My goal's too big. He had to narrow it down. Because you have to be careful with measuring a habit because measuring's not the goal. We can get distracted by that if we're not careful. But to ask what is hopefully an obvious question, what's the number one enemy of maintaining a habit? Failure, to perform the habit. That's where it all breaks down, isn't it? One time of forgetting or failing, though, doesn't doom us in a new habit. But two or three times we're starting to develop a different pattern, aren't we, than what we want. So that's what we have to be careful of. We can't break the pattern too often, too long, or we won't continue in it. So let's go back as I begin summarizing this up. How do we make something immediately satisfying? Well, you can make a contract with someone. Studies have shown somebody that wants to go to a gym, if they have somebody to go to the gym with them, they'll stick with it longer. They'll meet their goals better because now they're accountable to someone. Maybe there's someone you can share what you want to overcome that will keep your confidence, and you can say, you can hold me accountable. And maybe you talk regularly. How are you doing? Well, this week I didn't do so well, but I realized whatever, and they can say, yeah, that's a good observation, and say, well, I'm going to call you next week, and I'm going to see how well you've done since then. We also have to remember the whole the spiritual component of all of this. We're not doing this on our own. But we have to be careful also how we ask it. Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 10. What in analyzing ourselves and examining ourselves, we have to also consider asking God to show us. And this is where Jeremiah 10 comes in, verse 23. O Eternal, I know the way of man is not in himself. Apart from God, mankind doesn't know how to live. It is not in man who walks to direct his own steps, because, again, we're lazy, we're carnal, we'll go down paths that have not so good outcomes. Right? Mankind doesn't know how to do this, really. Verse 24 then, O Eternal, correct me, but with justice, which means a whole lot of things in application. Don't overwhelm me. This is one of the things I really appreciate about the calling God gives us. You know, when I sit down to counsel someone for baptism, if I had known at my baptism all the things that God would want me to address over the almost 50 years since then I was baptized, if he told me that all at once, I probably would have said, no, I don't think so, because it would have been too overwhelming, right? But he works with us here and then here, gradually, mercifully, to not overwhelm us. And this is what verse 24 is saying. Correct me, but with justice, you know, patiently, with mercy, not in your anger, lest you bring me to nothing. We need to start with ruling ourselves. This is Genesis 4, verse 7, where God told Cain, all right, sin's there. You have to learn to control how you accept that or that you shouldn't, but even the examining ourselves. But then we can ask God also to show us and to help us. Because, as it says here, and even in verse 23, is similar to James 1, where James talks about how we look in a mirror and we see ourselves and we walk away and we forget everything we saw, right? We start out the day, we comb our hair, we do whatever, you know, make sure my tie's, I ask Roxanne now, because I did it for too many years, is my tie straight? That bothered her for a lot of years. Because I would just tie it, it looked fine. I didn't realize it had gotten all skewed or whatever. But we forget too easily, don't we? What our self looks like spiritually. God's word can be used like a mirror so that we can see what we're really like in this examining. Then let's conclude in Psalm 119. Psalm 119 and verse 134. Redeem me from the oppression of man, that I may keep your precepts. Buy me back. In the context of today, help me to see what I need to overcome. Help me to establish the right habits that will help me overcome, that I can keep your precepts, that I can learn to become like you. Because God wants us to live in eternity as he does. That was the whole reason he created mankind, to eventually bring everyone that would desire it into his family. But in order for him to give us eternal life, we must overcome our carnal nature and take on his mind. This is Philippians 2:5, right? To take on the mind of Christ, to think like him, act like him, be like him, so that he'll know that we will live that way for eternity. Overcoming bad habits and sin is not as hard as we might think it would be. We have the tools, we have the knowledge available to us, we have the directive from God to overcome, we have God's Spirit to guide and strengthen us. So what do you want to overcome in your life? Do you have a plan for overcoming sin?